Welcome to the Worth Listening Podcast, where we focus on having positive and productive conversations about money. Join your host, Lauren Williams, four-time Olympian turned financial planner, as her guests share their money stories. We aim to help you own your personal money story and feel good talking about it. Money is a tool that can help you live the life you want. You should feel comfortable listening, sharing, and communicating about it. Now, here's your host, Lauren Williams.
Hi, and thanks for tuning in today. This week, I sit down with Major League Soccer player Amobi Okugo, entering his ninth season as an MLS player. Amobi has been playing soccer since he could walk and found success from a very young age. However, athletic success was not his only goal. No pun intended. He committed and followed through on a promise to his parents to obtain his undergraduate degree and even attend college while being a professional athlete. Amobi shares with us the financial lessons he has learned along the way and why it's important for teams and peers to discuss finances with each other. He believes in the accumulation of financial knowledge and has started a website, Frugal Athlete, to help athletes do just that. No one can tell their story better than you. So, without further ado, here's Amobi Okugo sharing his money memoir with us. All right, Amobi, we'll just jump right in. Let's start with something simple. What was your first memory of money?
Oh, so my first memory of money, I'm Nigerian American. So growing up, I went to a lot of Nigerian parties and stuff like that. At the parties, you know, we have this little ceremony when everyone dances, or say the bride and groom at a wedding, they dance. People spray money. It's kind of like a form of endearment to help them in their new journey, or just to spray money. It's like a thing you do. Growing up, I never really understood it, but I was always the little kid, like trying to go with my little brother, like pick up the money, and my aunties and my uncles, like, you can't do that. Little slap me on my wrist and stuff like that. So that was my first memory of money.
Well, whose money was it? It was the money of the person whose wedding it was, right?
Yes. So basically, instead of like a registry, the bride and groom, they would have their dance and people come in and spray money to them. And it's usually for them to use that money to start on their new journey, or use the money to pay for the party or stuff like that. So it wasn't my money at all.
I mean, your aunt could have shared, like, gave you, let you have $1. You don't think, like, no?
Yeah, it was cool. As I got older, I got to participate and, you know, be the one spraying the money. So sometimes I would pick up money and act like it was mine and spray it to the people that we were celebrating. So that was my first initial memory of money.
So let's talk about how your parents, what role they played then. Like you said, you talked about the wedding being your first memory of money. What did they do for a living? Where were they in creating your memories of money as a child?
Yeah, so growing up, I mean, both my parents work in the state of California in disability insurance for EDD. So growing up, we weren't by any means wealthy or anything like that, but we weren't poor. And my parents did a great job of instilling good financial practices, making sure every dollar was meant for something and not being wasteful with how we spent money. It's funny growing up, because growing up, I obviously play soccer. We were shopping at Big Five for my soccer cleats. And then now my brother, my youngest brother, he's 16. He has the newest Adidas shoes, newest Nike shoes. So it's good to see how far I've come, or how far our family has come in terms of just being frugal and, you know, being financially astute in our practices.
For sure. Let's talk a little bit more about that wedding and that first memory of money you had there. What money behavior was created by that memory? Do you think it was like one of sharing and caring, or what was that for you?
For me, it was just because I was so young. I just thought it was like a Nigerian thing. You know, Nigerians like to be lavish and like to party. So I didn't really think anything of it in terms of, oh, that's how you have to spend your money. I just knew that when it comes to celebrating, you're supposed to celebrate as a community, as a family, and you're helping your family or who you are close with to help them on their new journey, or you're helping them pay for the party, or you're acknowledging their achievement. When it came to money in that sense, you're empowering from within through money or gifts and stuff like that. And any excuse to party is to party.
I think that's a really good point, really being able to empower from within and the ideas of what that speaks to with supporting a community and becoming one with a group of people as it pertains to sharing the finances and, you know, being caring about the people around you, but in a really positive and open way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I completely agree.
Were your parents strict, or you talked about like not being rich by any means and doing frugal shopping, but were they very strict with you, or did you have an allowance? What did it look like in the household?
Allowance. Oh, yeah, I did not have an allowance. My parents were very strict, but strict in a good way. You know, looking back on it, I would never change it for the world. I think I grew up with the best parents. They've been amazing throughout my whole life and career, just instilling in me and my siblings just ideal morals, ideal skills to help us navigate in this life and in this world with the politics and how everything's going on. So I'm very grateful for how they were strict on me and my siblings growing up, me in particularly, because I'm the oldest of four siblings. So I think I got it the most, not even saying it to take a dig at them, but just being the oldest as a first generation Nigerian American, I think I got it the most, but I'm very grateful for how it all came about.
So what was that relationship like with your siblings then? Do you think that they saw the household the same way that you did with the parents, like you said, being very strict? Or is it kind of like you were the first one, like you said, you got the brunt of it, and then the others kind of were willy-nilly, they got everything they want? Or how do you think that played into like your role in the overall relationship with money? Like, what were your siblings' role in that?
I think it's funny because I was like the trial. So they would try things on me, and then if it worked, then it would work for the siblings. If not, then they would do different things for the siblings. Or I was basically like the punching bag kind of. So I got in trouble the most. I was, you know, looked at the most. And from then on, my siblings were to use me as sort of a role model. And my parents, as they got older and started, you know, getting acclimated to the American way of life, they started getting accustomed to how it's done differently. And my siblings, as much as I love them, I swear they're so spoiled when it comes to how me and at least my closest brother in age were raised. It's funny when I look back on it, but it helped me personally, and it helped our relationship between me and my siblings and how I kind of take care of them as part older brother, part third parent in a sense.
Yeah, I think it's a cool responsibility to have, to be the first, but to also be the example and have that responsibility, but also, you know, to feel grateful and excited to share that responsibility versus, you know, some people are like, man, why am I the oldest? And I mean, being the oldest does come with some perks, right?
Exactly.
So like, for instance, you were the first person to turn 16. Did you get a car?
Oh, no, I didn't get a car until my senior year. So,
okay. So in high school, you were able to get a car.
Yeah. Yeah. I was lucky my senior, and it wasn't like my car. I was borrowing it whenever my dad was off work and I got to use it on weekends. So like, you bring up a great point. So being the first, I was able to do all these things first, but I did everything late. So my brother, my sister, they all got cars when they were 16, right when they were eligible. I didn't get my first phone till I was a freshman in high school. My little brother, who was in seventh grade, had a phone. So, I mean, as time moves on, all these things are more prevalent to society, but it just hurts me because I had to wait my freshman year and this guy's sixth grade, seventh grade on his iPhone, and I'm like with the flip phone.
Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about where soccer fits into all of this. You are an MLS player, but were you playing from what age?
Yeah, so before I could even walk, I was at the park. My dad used to take me to the park and basically just run me and give me drills. It wasn't until I started playing for my school team where I was on an organized soccer team. And then from there, it just kept picking up. So I played on my school team up until fourth grade. And then from there, I went to the local competitive team. And then I tried out for the ODP team. It's like the Olympic Development Program. They don't do it anymore. So I tried out for my district ODP team, then I moved up to my state team, then I moved up to my regional team, and then from there, I was picked to the first national team camp for my age group, and then it just kept progressing. A little backstory, obviously, Nigerian American, our family's very big on soccer, especially in Nigeria. Soccer is like the main sport. So growing up, we were always watching soccer, especially during the early 90s, the 94 World Cup that was in the States, and the 96 Olympics, where Nigeria was actually did well in both tournaments. They ended up winning the 96 Olympics against Argentina. They beat Brazil in the semis. Soccer has been part of our family for as long as I can remember. So I was automatically going to play soccer growing up. And luckily for me, it was from the first moment I started, I just was fortunate enough to keep progressing higher and higher. And eventually it led to scholarship at UCLA. And then now in my upcoming ninth season as a pro.
So playing soccer as a young adult, did you decide you wanted to be a soccer player when you grew up? Or did you have other goals and aspirations with soccer? You just did something you just did for fun.
So it's funny you say that, because growing up, I really wanted to just be a professional athlete. It was either soccer or basketball. So those were my two main sports growing up. Obviously, I had realistic goals. I always knew I wanted to be rich, because growing up, I always asked my parents if I was came across someone that had a big house or nice car or, you know, had a good job. I always wanted to know, like, how much do they make or what do they do to make a lot of money? So I knew that's what I wanted to do, or wanted to be rich. It wasn't until I was invited to the residency program. And the residency program is basically the top 40 high school kids in the nation attend the residency program located in Bradenton, Florida, where we use the IMG facilities and go to school. So it's basically like a boarding school for the top 40 kids at the under 17 level. And you compete.
Is that at your expense or is that at the expense of the program?
Oh, no, the program. So the U.S. national team pays for everything. So you basically compete, train every day, go to school, travel the world, and then you ultimately try to make the U-17 World Cup team and do well there. So it wasn't until I got invited there and went there where I was like, okay, being pro is going to be a viable option. Because when I first started, my parents were just, you know, you love soccer, you play soccer, hopefully you can develop friendships and off the field activities. And then once I started progressing, they were like, okay, maybe you can get a scholarship out of this. But then once I got invited to residency and people started like talking to my parents, they're like, professional opportunity is more than likely going to happen. And I mean, the rest is history.
All right. So how did you end up in college then? How did you find your way to UCLA? And what was your goal in attending initially?
So after I finished my 2-year cycle with the residency program, I came back from my senior year of high school in Sacramento. And my parents are big on education on top of all the other things they're big on. And especially being the first born in a Nigerian family, I was going to go to college no matter what, no matter how many opportunities I had to go pro out of high school. I was fortunate enough to have quite a bit of options. The agreement, my parents, it wasn't really an agreement. It was basically them saying, I'm going to go to one of the 4 California schools. So it came down to Stanford, UCLA, Cal, and Santa Clara. Fortunately for me, UCLA is the best school that's farthest away. And the campus is amazing.
Why would a kid ever want to be the furthest away from their parents?
Yeah, I don't know why. And they have a prestigious soccer program. So I ended up going to UCLA for my freshman year. Fortunately, we had a great season. From there, agents started reaching out and teams started reaching out. I just had to convince my parents that I wanted to do this professional thing. And they were kind of against it at first because I just had got to UCLA and giving away a full ride scholarship to pursue a professional career. But I promised my parents that I would finish my education while I'm playing, and the program that I signed with for when I went pro was going to pay for my school anyway. So it was basically a win-win. I'm fortunate enough to be able to play pro and just completed my degree. So I did my promise and they're happy.
I think that's a really cool thing that you bring up, these new opportunities when athletes are deciding to forego their eligibility at a college, university, whoever it is that's kind of willing them out of school. Contracts can be written any way that you want. You know, it's your ability to negotiate, your agent or your lawyer's ability to negotiate. And so why not go after getting your education paid for, even though you decided not to go to college and participate in the NCAA program? So I think it's great that you had that built into your contract and that you got your education and were able to do the same things that, you know, the person who decided to stay in school did. So let's talk a little bit more about what the process is like going pro. So you're 18 years old, freshman in college, you decided to go through this process. How does it all play out for you?
It's crazy. There's so many different ways. Like, obviously, as you know, not one path fits all. So luckily, our team was good. We had a lot of good seniors that kind of led our team and a couple underclassmen that really punched above their weight. So we ended up making the Elite Eight. Unfortunately, got out. I'm still bitter about it. We got out in the Elite Eight. I had a good season. I was Pac-12 Freshman of the Year, made all Pac-12 team and stuff like that. So a couple of agents had reached out to my UCLA coach and to my parents. Basically said that I was projected to be a top pick in the upcoming MLS draft. I had a couple options overseas, but the MLS, with the way that they were offering the education and the top pick and possible good situation, I ended up signing with the agent and making myself eligible for the MLS draft.
Okay, so I have a good question about how much does an agent get paid in the soccer world? Because, for example, in track and field, it can be somewhere between 15 and 20%.
Agents in the soccer world, it's all contingent on what is agreed upon, but I'll try to give you like the standard. A standard basically is up to 5% of your actual contract through the team, what your team pays you. And then usually the standard is like 10 to 15 to 20%. Sorry, that's a large range, but 10 to 20% of all marketing and promotional endorsement deals, they'll get their percentage or their cut. So for my first initial deal, they were taking 5% from my MLS contract and then through other sponsorships, like through Adidas and a couple other sponsorships I had, they were taking 15%. But that's just for me personally. It can all be negotiated with you and your agent or you and your lawyer or you and your marketing person. But that's basically the standard for at least soccer.
No, for sure. I think like it's really good to know, like you said, how it varies across industry. It's not one size fits all for all the various sports. So we talked a little bit about agent. Now you're on the team. You're earning a good living. What did you do with that first paycheck when you became a pro player at 18 years old?
I had my signing bonus. I mean, it was more than I ever made. The only job I had growing up was reffing games and, you know, selling chicken wings my mom gave me at lunch to like my classmates. You know, when you have money, it's different. So the first thing I did with my big paycheck was put it in a CD. And basically it's a account where it grows interest, but it's not at a tremendous rate. It's more to make sure you're not touching your money. So I did that.
You put all of it in a CD?
I put over 75% of my signing bonus into a CD account that would open again in a year.
That's awesome. And so who was helping you make these decisions? Did you also have like a financial planner, financial advisor, in addition to an agent? Is this your parents helping you?
Yeah. So it was basically me and my dad. He's like my financial advisor, manager, agent at the same time. So we decided that that was the best route because I was too young to know what stocks to invest in or where's the real estate market going to go. So he's just like, put this money into a CD, see how the market goes, learn about your budget, how the soccer world works, you know, where your money's coming in and out of, and just try to accumulate that knowledge. So when this money comes out, you can decide what to do with it.
Oh, you just hit home on such a good point. The accumulation of knowledge. I think sometimes that's one of the mistakes that we make is we get something, a big windfall of money or, you know, our tax return, something like that. And it's like, okay, what do I do now? What do I do now? And it's okay to kind of put it on pause. And that's kind of what you guys did by choosing a CD. It's like, I don't have to hurry up and invest and make my money grow today. I don't have to jump into something that I don't know. We can put this on pause, be responsible with it, go educate ourselves, and then decide what to do with it. And I think that's such a great lesson for everybody to take home is when you get anything that's just money that's unexpected, take a moment, pause, and then decide, educate yourself and what your options are, and then decide what to do.
Perfect. I mean, you bring up a great point. In hindsight, looking back, I'm like, oh my gosh, what if I put that in Visa or what if I put that in Netflix? But like you said, you need to have that knowledge first because just as I could have put up those things that did well, I could have put it in something that would have lost a lot of money. So to have that knowledge, like you said, accumulate knowledge so you can make the best decision for yourself it's vital.
All right. So this is your first big paycheck. And then, you know, you get through your first season. At what point did you start to reevaluate things and start to come up with a plan for how you're going to create your financial earnings and your savings and your spending? And what was next in the process?
Yeah, so I did that. I didn't even have a car my first year. So I built a pretty good nest egg. I opened up a separate life insurance policy. And then I opened up a Scottrade account and I readjusted my 401k account.
I think you bring up a good point there. And what does it have in soccer? Because frequently in professional sports, sometimes you're a 1099 employee. The MLS is an organized league. So you are a W-2 employee of your team. What was the name of your team again?
I got drafted to Philadelphia Union. So I was an employee through the Philadelphia Union and MLS because MLS is a single entity. So it owns all the teams.
So did they spend any time like, you know, with a rookie kind of financial literacy or explaining what the 401k is and other retirement options, employee benefits, insurance, things like that?
They do a pretty good job. It's been growing over the years. So my first year at the rookie symposium, rookie seminars, the preseason seminars for the teams, they usually have a financial guy or financial people to come and talk to the players. As the league has grown, as they have grown and invested more resources, they've started to do more workshops and stuff like that. But my first year, I didn't even know the difference between a Roth and a traditional 401k plan. Like you said, like that accumulation of knowledge after that first year, I was able to readjust my 401k portfolio to make it conducive to what I want to invest in or how I want to invest, whether I want to be aggressive or patient, stuff like that. So I was able to readjust my 401k, open up a Scottrade account, open up a life insurance policy, and do some other things where I felt comfortable to start building my financial portfolio, my financial playbook.
Oh, financial playbook. I like the term. I might have to steal that. I usually say financial game plan. So we're on the same lines. I think you bring up a good point, though, about not knowing. At 18 years old, how can you know what your 401k is or your Roth? And even in a symposium of sorts where they spend an hour or two, you know, there's so many different topics to cover at one period of time. So it's really important that people take time to say, okay, I don't get this. I need to go learn more about this. I need to read more about this, understand more, et cetera. So just really driving home that point. Now, let's talk a little bit more about what money is like in your profession. We talked about your personal situation and how you decided to handle your finances as a Major League Soccer player. But what is it like in Major League Soccer? You know, you hear NFL stories of players gone broke and not being responsible, et cetera. What's that locker room talk like as it pertains to money in the MLS?
It's a little different because MLS is still a growing league. It's not even 30 years in existence. The league started in 94. So the league is growing in terms of money. You have guys on the lower end, and then you got guys making millions of dollars. So there's a big gap when it comes to what everyone's financial playbook or financial game plan looks like. So it's interesting because a lot of the players are obviously going to have to work when their careers are over. Even the ones that are making a lot of money, if they're not planning the right way, they're probably going to have to work after their career is over as well. So our conversations are different to the NBA guys or the NFL guys. It's interesting to be in the locker room and hear some of the mindsets of some of the guys because we have a different perspective in terms of how we plan, how we budget, how we forecast our yearly plan, our financial goals compared to other sports where I have friends in these other sports where they can do a little bit more with their cash and their portfolio.
So you guys are, in fact, having conversations in the locker room or at practice or whenever, you know, so while you're spending time together, it is a subject that it's okay to talk about. Like, hey, man, did you put as much as you could in your 401k? Or,
oh, yes.
Those are conversations that you all are having amongst one another.
The MLS community is actually very good in terms of, I mean, I've been on four teams now. I think they've done a great job. The players, you know, have been invested in their finances and helping each other out. My rookie year, it was a veteran that told me I can invest a max amount into my 401k. And then when I was in Orlando, it was another buddy of mine on the team that told me if I wanted to start a nonprofit or I wanted to start training kids on the side, it would be better to start an LLC to protect myself, whereas if something were ever to happen, someone can't sue my personal account. They would have to sue the LLC. So things like that, people are helping each other out and information is being shared across the board. Especially when you have guys that are trying to grind and some of them are even trying to do like hustle on the side. They want to be able to build their portfolio.
Yes.
Compared to some of the guys on the larger pay scale where they're investing in some startups and doing different things compared to a guy building his portfolio through another platform.
It's so great to hear that those conversations are being had, because communication is really the key to minimizing the amount of mistakes that you make. I think the biggest mistake that sometimes is made is people feeling like they can't communicate with someone, or that, you know, their situation is so unique that they can't share it, when in fact communicating with someone is the thing that will allow you to get a little nugget or a little tidbit. And then that'd be the thing that allow you to know, okay, let me go look in this direction because, you know, I have at least this much information. So let me go over here and learn more about that little tidbit that I got. So it's great that you guys have that kind of communication going on. All right, let's transfer over to talking a little bit about what the cost of being an athlete is. So the kind of expenses you incur to be great at your job.
Oh, whew. It's lucky because I don't know if you ever came across that article, but it was the article about LeBron James, how he spends $1 million on recovery and to make sure he can perform at the best possibility he can. And it was interesting to me because, I mean, this is LeBron James. He's like a brand within himself, one of the highest paid NBA players. But it was so interesting to see how much he spends on himself to make sure he performs at the highest level consistently. And I was thinking, I was like, I don't even have $1 million to spend on myself. So things that we pay for in terms of off the field, recovery is so important. Whether it's yoga or massages or Normatex to help your legs recover. That's what a lot of things that athletes pay for. Going out to eat or groceries. When you're on the road, you going out to eat with your teammates, or even when you're at home in the home location, going out to eat, you know, building team chemistry. Shopping. Athletes, for some reason, love shopping. That's another expense.
I think one of the biggest things that you drove home is that there's a lot that goes into being able to compete at your highest level. And really investing in yourself is important. And I think that's something that people kind of forget to look at, is this idea of, okay, I got all this money. What do I do with it? You need to budget to continue to be great. And you need a budget to invest in yourself so that you can continue whatever it is that you're excellent at, whether it's in a regular 9-to-5 sort of job or whether it's professional sports. Without that investment in yourself, you can't continue to get the return on the investment that got you the nice paycheck in the first place. So,
yeah, thank you. Yeah, you covered it for me because I was trying to break it down to expenses that are necessary for you to perform at your highest level. And then there's expenses for you to have fun. If you want to spend your money to have fun, you better make sure you're able to perform, because if you're not able to, you won't have the money to have fun. So you broke it down way better than I could, and I thank you for that.
What was one of the things that you least expected in this whole process?
I didn't expect, in terms of finances and stuff, is how much extra money you can make if you're smart about it through team appearances and volunteering and endorsement deals and stuff like that. Because I really just thought it was, okay, you have your apparel sponsorship and then you have your team contract and that was it. But depending on who you are as a player, how your brand is off the field, there's so many more opportunities for you. And it's not just for the big superstar on the team. It could be for the depth piece or the utility guy. Every player has their own niche within their profile. And it's up to the player and his team, of course, to build that out and make sure he's performing within his role on the field and doing the things that he can do off the field. That's one thing I didn't expect when I was first coming into the league.
Yeah, athletes have such a huge platform. And like you said, it's not just the first round, first pick, or the person who's on the billboard that the league has chosen, but it's how you decide to carry yourself and continue to build your platform. Because being an athlete, we are charged with that responsibility of being a role model, and that in and of itself gives you a platform, and then you can continue to build on that platform as you see fit. Like you said, everybody has their own niche, their own interests, their own responsibilities they can craft into other means of income.
Exactly.
Okay, so as a major league professional player, what about the people around you during these time periods? Did your family start to treat you differently? Did you get fake friends, or did your other friends start to treat you differently? Did they say, oh, you're a professional athlete, you must be rich? And did you have any experiences like that?
Yeah, I had a couple experiences. I mean, for the most part, you know, my family, we're very tight-knit, so they know I didn't change. The relationships didn't change. There's a couple things that they expected, but for the most part, everything was kept in-house, and any financial aid I moved, they already knew about it, and they were receptive and helpful in helping me build my platform and portfolio. Ultimately, if I'm able to build with myself up to where I see fit, I'm able to help them and their avenues or just help the family in general. In terms of friends and fake friends, I've always been pretty low key when it comes to my friends. So I've had my tight knit group of friends. But coming back to Sacramento in the off season, there's been some times where people are like, oh yeah, you must be nice, whatever, must be nice. And I know, I see how you rolling, blah, blah, blah. It's not to the level of like an NBA guy or an NFL guy where you go out to dinner and everyone's just quiet waiting for you to pick up the tab. I mean, I'll pick up the tab a couple times with my close friends, but I'm not just doing charity work when it comes to picking up tabs for people I don't consider close friends or family members. So for me, it's not as bad as it is for other people, but I've been in situations where it could easily have gone down that path if I didn't have a good support group.
I think you bring up a really good point about the eating out and the picking up tabs, because that is one of the stereotypical things or things that you see frequently. And I think no matter what earnings level you're at, there's always that awkward moment at the dinner table when in a group of people and everybody's eyes start darting around and you're like, oh my goodness, you know, I was trying to figure out like what's going to happen and no one's trying to claim it. And it's one of the we should be courageous enough to say from the very beginning, hey, separate checks, please. And as an athlete or the high earner of your family, whatever the case may be, if you're going out with a group of people and you feel like they might expect you to pay, to kind of set that expectation from the very beginning, because you're planning with your income. And like you said, it's one thing to plan to take your family out and tell them thank you or for the holidays or whatever the case may be, and to be generous because you plan to do so, versus to end up in a situation where a lot of people are hanging out and you all just happen to it be dinner time. And it's like, oh, the person with the biggest pocketbook pays the bill. That shouldn't be the case. And no one should have to feel that weird awkwardness that always ensues. And it's like, oh, you got it, player. You got the deep wallets. It's like, no, don't count what's in my pocket.
Exactly.
You came to dinner knowing that there was a cost for dinner, that it was being prepared by a company that wanted to make a profit. And you should be prepared to pay for dinner, because I didn't invite you here as a celebratory thing. So I think that's a really good one to hit on. You see, I went on a little tangent there.
No.
All right, so let's fast forward to where you are now. Present day, you're heading into your ninth season in the MLS. Who are the members of your financial entourage?
So right now, I'm trying to continue to build my portfolio. I have a couple goals set where I want to be financially. Luckily for me, I've been able to play so long. Hopefully, I can continue to do so. In terms of my personal financial team, I would say it's still me and my dad is the forefront of who's making the ultimate decisions. But I've connected with a couple other people to help strategically help me with certain aspects of where I want to go. So I got into some real estate. So I have a friend helping me out in that aspect who kind of advises me and stuff like that. Also another friend that helps with my stock portfolio. For the most part, that's basically it. Also a lawyer just for some legal documentation. As an athlete, it's good to set up your will, set up your trust fund, set up stuff like that. Just in case anything happens, injury, untimely illness, stuff like that, because you've built up a big nest egg. You don't want it to just all go away because of unfortunate circumstances.
So what would you say to someone? What advice would you give to someone listening who is trying to build a financial team around them? What kind of questions do you need to ask? What kind of criteria do you have in place to make sure that they're not going to be, you know, stealing your money or they know what they're talking about? How did you go about finding your team and making sure they were qualified to do the work that you've trusted them to do?
The one piece of advice I would share initially is don't be afraid to ask questions, because at the end of the day, I'm not an expert when it comes to finances, when it comes to terms and ideologies and stuff like that. So make sure they can explain it to you where you can go on and explain it to someone else. And if they're using big words to try to make themselves feel or seem like they're the best financial advisor, make sure they can break it down almost into ABC form. Act like you're in kindergarten and they're teaching you simple numerals and the alphabet and colors of the rainbow. Make sure that the way they break it down to you, it's so basic where you can go on and teach someone else, or you can go into whatever your portfolio, whether your stocks, or you can read your accounts and take their advice and actually act on it. So that's my big piece of advice. Ask a lot of questions.
I think that's a great point to hit home on, is this idea of making sure that it can be broken down for you. If someone is always constantly talking over your head, it's like, tell me that in a way that I can understand. And being patient enough to make sure that they tell you in a way that you can understand. Because sometimes they make it sound so fancy and complicated, and you just kind of like, oh, they must be really smart. Okay, I'll just go ahead and hire them. It's like, no, help me understand. Bring me to the level. Make sure that I'm educated as well. I'm hiring you to help me because you're the expert, but there's no reason that I can't understand what's going on within this world of whatever it is that I'm asking you to do.
Yeah, exactly. It's like a quarterback. You know, you have your bunch of plays. You have your wide receiver that's running a slant route, a post route, deep out. Just as if you're a football player explaining to someone the game of football and you're trying to break it down in simplest form, just reverse roles. Act like the guy's a financial advisor and they have to break it down to where you almost feel like, all right, cool. I have like my dictionary of terms. So for example, NDA. Okay, that's a non-disclosure agreement. So if I'm working with the marketing agency, I'm going to have them sign an NDA so they can't take my information and go somewhere else. Or full power of attorney or limited attorney. Just all these terms that you may need, or what's the difference between an LLC and a partnership and corporation. And if I want a nonprofit, do I want a for-profit or not-for-profit? Sorry, I'm just going on a tangent. You can see how excited I'm getting when I'm talking about all these terms that athletes may or may not know. And they ask their business managers and their financial advisors, and they're just giving them all these big words. And it just sounds good, but when it comes to, okay, why did we do it this way? They can't even answer it. So that's my big piece of advice. So hopefully it sticks.
I think it's great advice. Yeah. So now we're ready to wrap up, and we have a little bit of a lightning round.
Uh-oh.
It's like short, snappy answers. It doesn't have to be one word answers, but I got just a couple questions for you.
Okay.
So the first is, you've got $20 in your pocket right now. What do you spend it on?
Oh my goodness. $20 in my pocket right now. What am I spending it on? If I'm hungry, I'm spending half of it on food and then I'm just keeping the rest.
Yeah. Most athletes always go the food route.
Yeah. We always like to eat.
What is the best thing about being an athlete?
The best thing about being an athlete is not only the relationships you're making with teammates and rivalries off the field, it's being able to travel the world and also play the sport you love and get paid while doing it. I've been able to play soccer for a living and meet so many cool people, travel to so many cool places. It's just been a blessing.
Awesome. What is your worst money habit?
Oh, my worst money habit. You're calling me out. I'm supposed to be the frugal athlete. My worst money habit would be, because it's actually perfect timing, when it comes to gifts and keeping within my budget. Because every year I have a budget of what I'm going to give my family, my girlfriend, and I'm like, all right, I'm sticking to this budget. But I always want to take care of my family, so I always somehow go over my budget. So I think that's my worst money habit, being strict about my budgets.
It's good that you have a budget, though. What is the most meaningful gift you've received and why?
Most meaningful gifts. Gosh, oh, you got me stuck on this one. This is supposed to be wraparound and I'm over here taking my time. Okay.
Right.
My parents, they gave me life.
All right. Yes.
Sorry, I'm so boring when it comes to that one. Yeah, life is a gift.
All right. Best advice you've ever received?
A quote my dad always used to tell me. All you can do is all you can do, and all you can do is enough. It was by A.L. Williams. He has a book out, and it's actually called All You Can Do Is All You Can Do, and All You Can Do Is Enough. He was a high school football coach, ended up being a big-time insurance salesman. But that quote just – I don't know if it's because my dad told it to me all throughout my childhood or because it actually means a lot to me, because, I mean, the quote, like, all you can do is all you can do. You can't really control anything else that happens, but as long as you do what you're put on this earth to do and you give it your all, more often than not, good things are going to happen. And I've taken that approach with everything I've done in life, whether it's soccer, whether it's school, whether it's starting my entrepreneurship and with Frugal Athlete. So yeah, I think that's my quote, my advice.
That's cool. So at Worth Winning, we have two models. We're just going to go one today. And one of them is you don't have to get it all right to be all right. So we all make mistakes, but it's not the mistake that's going to be the crippling thing. It's your inability to be open and really deal with the cause of the mistake. And so we're all about transparency and being open and communicating in order to prevent people from making catastrophic problems in their finances. So with that said, our final question is, can you share with us just one thing that you would like to improve about your finances in the upcoming year?
One thing I would like to improve about my financial playbook in the upcoming year is to know where my money is going in all aspects and not just having my budget, the rent, utilities, bills. I want to know as I increase my businesses off the field, I want to know where my money is coming in, where my money is coming out. So just being more on top of, I guess, my expense report and then my income report. I don't know if that answered your question to the fullest, but I think that's my big goal.
So what's the action item then? You want to be more on top of it. What are you going to do to make the change? Like, what's going to make it different?
I'm trying to develop this whole Excel spreadsheet for all my accounts. And then I'm going to download one of these apps. I'm trying to, if you have any recommendations, please share. But one of those apps that calculates where you're spending your money, just kind of try to put it into like a big database for me personally and just be able to see where, all right, this is where I'm getting money from sponsorships. This is where I'm spending money from Frugal Athlete. This is where I'm spending money from my personal account for rent and all this stuff. This is where my real estate, just have everything together because it's been everywhere separate before. So now I'm going to try to bring it all into one hub.
Great. Yes, there are many apps for that. I will say, go ahead and give the free marketing away. You Need a Budget is my favorite app. It's literally called You Need a Budget.
Okay.
Look, they're not paid for that advertisement. So that's as far as I'm going to go. Google it, people. It's a great app. Okay. So let's just wrap up with what are you up to now? You mentioned Frugal Athlete a few times. Tell us a little bit about that and any other endeavors that you have going on and then where we can find you. How can we help?
Yeah, you noticed I was trying to plug it. I was trying to plug a Frugal Athlete. So a Frugal Athlete, basically, I just started it a little over a year ago. It's a website platform business that is used to hopefully promote financial literacy and share prudent financial practices amongst athletes. I feel like as athletes, we are natural trendsetters. And if we can help promote financial literacy and share prudent financial practices amongst athletes, it'll be great. Not every athlete's on the LeBron James level, the Kobe Bryant level. So it's important for athletes, both at the professional level, at the student athlete level, and even the fans that follow these athletes to be smart about their finances and increase their financial literacy. You can find me at Amobi Says on Twitter and Instagram, AmobiSays. Or you can follow a Frugal Athlete on Twitter and Instagram. I'm also on LinkedIn. I think that's it.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for being on the show today, Amobi. All your insights and wisdom were wonderful.
No, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure, and I hope to be a reoccurring guest.
All right. Well, we hope to have you back. I hope you enjoyed listening to Amobi's Money Memoir. One point Amobi shared is the importance of educating yourself before making financial decisions. When you come into money that's beyond your established budget, it's okay to put it on hold before rushing out to make a decision on whether you're going to spend or invest or what you're going to do with it exactly. Hasty actions often lead to big mistakes. Amobi also shared the importance of finding a financial team that will educate you instead of throwing out big words or financial terms to make themselves look smarter. They should be able to break things down into everyday terms so you understand it enough to explain it to someone else. Speaking of big words and financial terms, it is time for our word of the day, CD. This stands for Certificate of Deposit. CDs can be purchased from financial institutions like banks or credit unions. And basically, you agree to give them your money for a certain period of time, and they provide a small amount of interest on the funds they've loaned you. They're pretty safe and meant for short term, so they don't pay a bunch of interest. In Amobi's money memoir, he used a CD to hold his money while he educated himself on other investment options and strategies. Thank you for tuning in today. We hope you found this episode worth listening to. If you have financial questions, suggestions for guests, or would like to share your own money memoir, please contact us through our website, worth.com. freshmen-listening.com.